Good afternoon, everyone. So as Pascal just said, I'm Caroline Pelletier and I work as a chemometrician in the CSG of Dijon in ChemoSense platform. And I am going to talk to you about a methodology to pair PTRMS with TDS or Tkata data. So the context of my presentation is that we have several dynamic methods to measure what happens during a tasting. We have, for example, some chemical methods, such as PTRMS, which consists in measuring volatile molecules directly in the subject's nose during tasting. And we also have sensory methods, which can be temporal, such as TDS or Tkata. These methods consist in asking the subject to score dynamically their sensations, with some difference between the methods that I'm going to explain later. So the question of my presentation is, are there differences between pairing PTR and Tkata and PTR and TDS? So one only chemical method and two sensory methods. So first I'm going to present the dataset pairing PTR with TDS and Tkata. Then I'm going to simply show the PCA comparison of TDS and Tkata results. And finally, I am going to show you how to pair PTRMS with sensory data with a multi-block method, which is RDCCA. So the dataset is a dataset of three chocolates, A, B, and C, which was collected in 2019. So these three chocolates were previously characterized by a profiling task. So A was more fruity, B was more spicy, and C was more cocoa and woody. And these chocolates were tasted by 16 panelists four times, because we had two times by doing a TDS task and two times being Tkata task. So in fact, we have four evaluation per product and subject. So the procedure for one evaluation is as following. So first we connect the subject to the PTRMS device with singing in his nose. So we have a blank period during which the breathing is measured in order to correct it after that. Then after this 30 second period, the subject click on start and begins the task of sensory scoring. So as a reminder, in TDS, you click on, if you are the subject, you put the product in your mouth, then you click on start. Then you feel some dry fruit, so you click on dry fruits because you think that it is a more dominant sensations. Then you think about spicy, so you click on spicy, and then you don't feel anything else and you click on stop. So this is TDS task. And we have also Tkata. So Tkata, it is kind of the same thing, but that you can unclick the attributes. So as an example here, I put the product in my mouth, I click on start. I feel some cocoa, so I click it. I think, oh, there is some woody too. So I can click on cocoa, but here, as you can see, I can click on both cocoa and woody. That is a thing that I couldn't do on the previous protocol. So, okay, I feel some woody, I feel again some woody and cocoa. No, I don't feel woody anymore, so I unclick it. And finally, I feel also cocoa again, and then I don't feel anything, so I click on stop. So, so here at the end of these steps, we have the same subjects which have done this TDS and Tkata task two times for each product. So here are the results of the byproduct PC and the product mains. So here are the separate results. We have on the left TDS result, so we can see that as expected by profiling task done before, A was more fruity here, B was more spicy, and C was more cocoa woody. And we have that for TDS and for Chicata. So we have the same sensory conclusions, but it appears that we should see, we could see best discrimination in TDS here because the confidence ellipses, which are the project, the individual projection on the PCI biplot, which are summarized by an ellipsis here, are more separated in TDS than in Chicata. So the question is, okay, there are maybe A and B are well discriminated in TDS, but are they in chemistry? And in this purpose, we need to relate TDS, maybe, so we need to relate three blocks of measurements, TDS, Chicata, and PTR. So we have to look at some multi-block methods. So this is the moment that I am going to talk to you about a regularized generalized canonical correlation analysis, so RGCCA. So this method was introduced by Tenenhaus, so father and sons, in 2011. And this method is based on the optimization of a covariance criteria. So this is this criteria here that I am going to develop. So the idea is to find some axes, here the AG, maximizing this criteria. So G here is the number of blocks. So here in our case, we are going to have three blocks, PTR, TDS, and Chicata, for example. So here we have the XJ, which are the blocks, J is the number of blocks. Here the covariance between the components. Here you can see that you find axes, you find axes on the block. So here you have finally XJ, AG is a component of the J blocks, and same thing for K. And here you get, you have the covariance between the components J and the component K. Then you have here a function, which can be very simple, such as identity or a square or absolute values, but it must be a convex function. We have also here CGK, which is something which is called a matrix of connection. In fact, this quantity equals zero if there is no connection between two blocks. For example, I have no connection between block one and block two, C12 would be a zero. And if there is a connection between these blocks, we would have one. And TOG here is a regularization parameter between zero and one. In my example, I always put it at one, and I am not going to develop it here, but it appears in the constraints here. So it's a kind of complicated criteria, but in fact, it's very interesting because by customizing this criteria, you can find out most of the multi-block methods that you know. For example, you can find back, so PCA is not really a multi-block method because you have only one block, but you can find back PCA by putting two times the same block. You can find back PLS. You can find back canonical correlation analysis, MFA, or so on. You have a really large number of methods which can enter in this framework. You just have to correctly choose the specific values of C, J, and Tau. So this is this method that I am going to use later, and the algorithm that the algorithm of this method is this one. So I'm not going to develop it that now, but what you should know is that it's an algorithm that has been demonstrated to be convergent. It's based on block relaxation. So in fact, you put you fix all block but one, and you maximize the criteria, then you change the block and so on. It's block relaxation type algorithm. It can be a Nipples type algorithm, so you can have some missing data in your data. And you also have further options that I am not going to develop there, neither, such as the ability to add super block options, for example, to find back PCA, that is a big block in which, in fact, you have all the blocks and you connect each block to this super block. You can find back further methods with that. You have sparsity, which is which can be included also in these algorithms. So this is SGCCA. And you can also work with multi-way data with, for example, temporal data, such as MGCCA. So it's a tensorial approach, a tensorial extension of RGCCA. And this package is available on GitHub and is maintained by Arthur Tenenhaus and its team. So in our example, we have three blocks with same individuals. So this is very important in all type of multi-block data. That is that we have the same individuals in all our blocks. So the first block is, in fact, the average of PTR-TDS and PTR-TKATA, which was pre-treated. And in fact, these blocks correspond to what happens in the mouse. So we have 38 ions. Then we have the standardized durations in TDS and the standardized durations in TKATA. The criteria that I choose was the maximization of the squares of the covariance between PTR-TDS plus PTRL and TKATA. So this is my connection matrix. And this approach, in fact, does not take the products into account, because here the notion of product is totally ignored by the algorithm. So in fact, this is really something which is relevant here, because in fact we can project the product and see what it gives. So here we can try to explain the duration by the ion intensities without knowing the product. So the underlying hypothesis is that we should find out back these product configurations, and that the compromise maximizing the sensory explanation by the chemical explanation should reflect the product viability. So here are the individual RGCCA maps. So here we have the that can be read exactly as a PCA. So here you have the individuals. We have in green the product A, in red the product B, and in C the product in blue the product C. Sorry, and so we can find that C was discriminated from A and B on the first axis for all blocks, both sensory, and chemicals. That A and B are discriminated on the second axis, here in PTR, in here in TDS, but it's not so clear in TKATA. So in fact, here we find back what we have previously seen on the discrimination of A and B on the second axis. After this analysis, we can try here to know whether some ions are strongly correlated here to cocoa and woody, which is strongly explained by the first axis. So here, that is written here. So TTS cocoa woody is strongly correlated to the first axis. That is the case also for TKATA. And so maybe there are some ions which could be strongly correlated to cocoa woody. So we have once again close conclusions for TKATA and TDS. And some ions appears more present in the product C, which is less fruity and more cocoa woody. These results can be and were validated with a bootstrap procedure. So that's it. So as a conclusion, RGCCA is a really powerful tool to deal with multi-block data. Here I choose an example, but there are many ways to do multi-block analysis. We have seen some similar sensory conclusions in TDS or TKATA, but TDS was found to preserve more the chemical discriminations than TKATA in all chocolate product space. So other criteria, such as repeatability, could be investigated to compare TDS and T-kata. And that is a teaser for Pascal presentation after the break.
Thank you very much, Caroline, for this. Sorry. You want to say something? Okay. So thank you very much for this very clear presentation. And we have time for questions. You were also perfectly on time. So please unshare your screen, Caroline.
Okay. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
So question. Do not hesitate. I haven't seen any question in the chat for the full session.
So feel free to use the chat. You can ask anything, even during the presentation. Don't ask for the question session. As soon as you have a question, you can raise it on the chat, and we will summarize it in the end.
John, cast your eyes here.
Yeah, I see John moving. Yes, if you want to ask a question. You have to come on the other side of the desk.
A little bit on the right, yes.
Excellent.
Fantastic. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you and see you.
Hi, everyone. Caroline, nice talk. I jokingly want to ask if you tried analyzing the data using ARG.
But using what?
ARG.
Oh, yeah.
but actually, I have a different question, which is that the characteristics of T-kata data and TDS data are very different in the sense that, you talked about it initially, and also there's a time element, and I'm wondering how you dealt with the fact that, you know, in TDS you could only pick one at a time, and in T-kata you could pick potentially many. And I'm curious too about, now I'm not very familiar with PTR and how it's used, but obviously in you know, when you have these ions that are being released, I think they're coming through the nose and you're measuring them as they're being exhaled. Is that right?
Yes. That you have something in your, I never did it, but you have something in your nose, and then you can measure the concentrations of ions during time. So you have also a temporality. So you have some curves as they are more closer, they are closer to T-kata curves than closer to TDS curves because by construction, of course, because you can have something like that.
Hmm. And so I guess my question is twofold. One is, how did you pre-treat the data in any way to deal with this multi-selection versus single selection? And in PTR, because you're exhaling ions, and that gives you kind of a chemistry measurement. Sensation is subject to phenomena like adaptation, sensory adaptation, where, you know, you become used to a certain ion, and then it kind of, even though it's present from a psychological standpoint, you're no longer noticing it. And I'm wondering how closely they should be related, and if that's taken into account in the model, that kind of sensory adaptation.
I'm not really familiar about all the mechanisms that are implied in the release of the ions, and in fact, that's something that's a kind of a black box. What's happened between what you have in your nose and what you put on your screen, and so the first about you talk about pre-treatment. The pre-treatment is something really really difficult to do. Actually, we have developed some stuff here, but we are at the beginning. For example, we have to deal with the breathing. We have to deal with a lot of things which are kind of complicated to deal with PTR. I'm not sure that I am answering your question, but regarding the link, because in fact, in TDS, you can only click on one thing. In fact, we don't take it into account. We only observe the durations and the total duration, and maybe it can be a bias, I don't know. And regarding the temporality, we have nothing also because I work with durations. So duration, you lose everything about temporality, but durations. So in fact, this temporality, we would like to take it into account. And I don't know if you remember what I told, but we would like to use tensorial methods such as MGCCS, so using cube of data instead of matrices to try to deal with that. Tell me if...
Yeah, no, these are interesting ideas. Thank you. I think some of it is you know, very, you know, obviously I'm curious about the details. So maybe I'll look forward to seeing it in a different context.
But, yeah, but you can meet in a private room during the break.
We are going to take a coffee.
Yeah.
All
right. Thank you, John. I think, Julien, you have a question because I saw you moving. Julien Rogue? No? No, maybe no, but he was moving close to the microphone.
I see a question in the chat. So...
Ah, okay. Can you read it, Caroline?
Yes. Why did you go for chocolate for your study? And do you think the conclusions are applicable to any kind of product? No, I my objective was not to to generalize to all products, and I don't know why we choose chocolate. In fact, because I arrived after the project, so I think it was partnership.
Because it's good, first. And no, chocolate is a very useful product for sensory analysis because most people like chocolates. You have temporality, because it takes time to eat a piece of chocolate, and it's easy to handle. So it's a reason why we are working a lot on chocolate. It's easier than wine. Although on a personal point of view, I still prefer working on wine, but. Okay, do we have another question or not? No? Okay.